are caught in the SF Vortex.
I don't have time to listen to this.
Make the time, because there's nowhere else to go to find out what's happening this week in sci-fi entertainment.
Let's hear it.
I'll make it quick, buddy. William Shatner revisits space, this time as an admiral in the perversions of science, and knows what it'll take to make this trip a success.
Willpower.
You got it, and so does Spawn. He exploded onto the big screen, and our War Room panelists are fired up to take on any holes in this latest comic adaptation.
Now stay sharp, the night is young.
You're not joking, because there's more. A trip to Comic-Con and even a peek inside a prototype spaceship called Event Horizon. What a lineup!
Well, I can see why they sent you.
Welcome to SF Vortex, everybody. I'm Roger Lodge, and you know, summer's just beginning to heat up, but as always, it's plenty hot right here in the Vortex, where we'll be taking a little trip into a parallel universe. We'll also look for a little love with none other than Mr. William Shatner, and we'll check in on the future of the human race on Mission Genesis. And things will get even hotter in the War Room when director Mark Dippé, screenwriter Eric Wallace, and sci-fi critic Robert Meyer Burnett rake Spawn the movie over the coals. Wow, how about that? Definitely one of the most visually spectacular films I've seen in a long, long time. All right, folks, here we go. We have made it down to the War Room, and joining me today, War Room regular Mr. Eric Wallace, screenwriter and genre film critic. Also here is Robert Meyer Burnett, sci-fi critic and film editor. And a new face here in the War Room, but certainly no stranger to the business, he is Mark A.Z. Dippé, the director of Spawn and the man who played a pivotal role in the creation of the groundbreaking 3D animation for such films as The Abyss, T2, and another film you just may have heard of, Jurassic Park. All right, guys, here we go. Welcome, first of all. Let's go to topic number one. Many of these comic books now hitting the big screen. You got Batman, you got Men in Black, Spawn, Steel coming up with Shaquille O'Neal, Mark Dippé. What are the ingredients needed to translate a good comic book to a good movie?
Well, the first thing for me is that comic books are a very natural medium to adapt a film because you have story with pictures together. It's a very obvious place to look for material. But one thing about comic books that makes them very strong is they create a world, a very rich world that has its own internal logic, its own sort of setting and atmosphere and tone, and it's very important to stay true to that if you want to capture the spirit of the comic book. I think today what people are reacting against a little bit is that there's sort of this sort of notion of comic books being kind of kitschy and silly, and that's not at all what comic books are really about as a whole.
Eric, do you agree?
Yeah, I'd have to look at something a little differently, though. I think the key ingredient for adapting a comic book is taking a premise. That's what comic books provide. They provide a world also, but they provide premises that are outrageous, fantastic, that audiences will love. And that's really the only thing you need. I think the other thing that's necessary to make a successful adaptation of a comic book is the same thing that you need for any other movie.
Which is?
Good writing. Good acting, good directing, and if you don't have those things, your movie isn't going to work.
And somehow work in Kevin Bacon. Right.
That too.
Robert, what do you think?
Well, I think one of the problems with comic book films is that they're not considered to be serious source material the way, say, a novel is. You have a comic book like, for instance, Batman and Robin is a perfect example of a film. The Batman comics within their pages strive to create a believable reality for the viewers or for the readers. The film Batman and Robin has nothing that we can grasp a hold of as an audience that's any way, shape, or form familiar. There's nothing real about those films, so we don't care about them. And hence, we just watch for 2 hours what's going on the screen without any kind of an emotional investment.
And what's real for you about Spawn?
Well, I think the thing about Spawn is he's a character that is a tragic, he's a tragic, classically tragic hero that is dealing with, he's lost his wife, he's lost his life, he's lost everything that matters to him, and he must strive to overcome that. Let's face it, he's a hell spawn. He's dealing with the devil. You know, you can't get much more tragic than that.
Eric Wallace, what worked for you in Spawn?
In Spawn, I think once again, I go back to the premise. It's just very cool to have a guy escape from hell and kick ass. That's good stuff. That's the only thing I need barred from the comic books. But on the other hand, I need a few other things that perhaps are absent from
the
film.
Well, actually, we need to sell a few things, so let's take a break. When we come back, there'll be lots more here about Spawn. Don't go anywhere, folks. We're right back. We'll be right back.
And I want to say to everyone in the war room, wherever you go, whatever you do, think Marvel.
We're down here.
Excelsior!
We're thinking Marvel, Stan, but right now we got our hands full with Spawn. Welcome back to the SF Vortex, everybody. We are still in the war room with Spawn director Mark A.Z. Dippé, screenwriter Eric Wallace, and sci-fi critic Robert Meyer Burnett. Guys, let's take a quick look here at a viewer letter. It is from Amy, and Amy writes, I think Spawn is a great thing. We get tired of superheroes and red capes flying around doing good, and I think the film will be enjoyable for those mature enough to understand what Spawn is. Wow. Now, Eric, you mentioned that there were a couple of things that didn't work for you in Spawn, which were?
I'd have to go with the script. The story, I don't think, works unless you know what Spawn is and you've read the comic book. As Mark, I think, would be the first person to agree, he's tried to make a movie that really works for the fans, that stays true to the dark roots. However, in doing so, I, as a Joe Blow viewer, who am not familiar with the comic, I don't know what's going on half the time. The script seems to be very dichotomous to me. People say one thing and then contradict themselves. Al Simmons is on a roof. He says, kid, I don't want any friends. The kid walks up and the next minute he says, hi, I'm Al Simmons. Good to meet you. Things of that nature. It just doesn't work for me.
Robert, did it work for you?
Well, I think one of the problems that I had with the film as well was, whereas the comics create a reality that I believe in, when I turn the pages of McFarlane and Greg Capullo's work, I believe it. But the film, the opening of the film had this great scene where they attack this airfield, and I'm like, great, it's like right out of a James Bond film, very cool. And then the reality was sort of tenuous, and it sort of unraveled for me, and I didn't believe what I was watching. I didn't believe the predicaments of the characters, and I didn't believe Al Simmons' plight either. I think they should have spent more time dealing with him as a man, as a person, rather than as a superhero.
I think part of that is backed up, though, by the way the world's shown in the film. You have the stuff on the alleys and on the rooftops, which seem like this gothic world out of Batman, but then you've got Al Simmons' home, which is suburbia. Those places don't even look like they're on the same planet, let alone in the same movie.
Mark, what do you think of all this?
Well,
all this yapping going on about your movie here.
Obviously, this isn't their movie, but, to me, I wanted to create, there's a sense even in the book, because you have to sort of suspend your belief from the start. Here's a guy that's back from hell. I mean, you have classic problems with comic book films. Here you have a guy, the clown, this squat, corpulent, 300-pound, disgusting, malicious beast, walking around with normal human beings.
My favorite part of the movie was John Leguizamo. I thought he was terrific.
The guy's brilliant.
Right.
Also, you have this notion of this kind of gothic, decayed city, but again, which there's human beings living normal lives. I mean, you have this kind of idea of this mixture of, in my mind, this phantasm of heaven and hell here on Earth. Now, why is there an alley? I mean, we can go and talk about all these points and all these ideas, but for me, why is Spawn even in an alley in a decayed Gothic church? To me, the notion there is symbolically, the people that are cast off, they're like this, they're the ones that are stuck between heaven and hell. Mm-hmm. Like the tenderloins of our cities are those places that accept anyone, those are people that have seen anything, they're the ones who are on the border between heaven and hell. They don't declare themselves as blatantly good or declare themselves as blatantly evil. So those kinds of ideas are very important to me for the place in which Spawn lives. But at the same time, Spawn is with people. Right. And the choice that I made was to go with this fact that there is this hidden world we all live in. So in other words, suburbia exists out there, will exist in 30 years from now, the gated communities. And those people will have the TV sets and the nice lawns and the happy children. But right next door to them will be this hidden world that is also part of their lives. And that to me is part of the world.
But as a viewer, I don't think that as a viewer of the film that all of those ideas were necessarily brought to me. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you look at, for instance, what I consider the best comic book adaptations, the first Superman film, mm-hmm. when you see the scenes of Superman in Smallville, especially when he's sitting on the sidelines as everyone's playing football and he asks his father, you know, I could get that football and make a touchdown every time. We as viewers, we can relate to that because we know we've always been there. We can relate to that as human beings. In Spawn, it's really difficult for me as a member of the audience living in 1997 America to connect with this world, to believe it.
Yeah, again, I mean, my response would be, it just depends on what you're after. See, to me, the world of Superman, again, is the men in tights. It's that kind of very simplified, the good guy eats Wheaties and he has got big shoulders, he's nice to girls. Spawn is a very, very different world. Spawn is a guy from hell that's fighting to save his soul, and he has a very tough choice to make, whether to like let his anger play. And in this world, I think it's very different. And one of the reasons it appeals, I think, to people is that, you know, we're all misunderstood. Things don't go the way we want them to. And that's sort of a lot of strength of what Spawn is about.
And things aren't going my way right now because I'm being told we're out of time. I gotta get out of here. I wanna thank my guests. I want to thank Mark Dippé, Eric Wallace, and Robert Meyer Burnett for joining me. Guys, will you come back soon?
Yeah.
There you have it, folks. There's more in the Vortex. Don't go anywhere. See you in a minute.